morning. You're very welcome. We're going to talk about trading delta, aren't we? What is delta and what is volatility?
I had time to prepare about volatility and I have no time to read about delta.
Fine, so that's fine. We can't do everything at the same time, but I first want to go over some things. Do you have on your own computer and anybody else who has joined now on your simulated trading platform, which is the same as mine, do you have it open at the moment?
I need to look. How to make it? Because now I can't get into my... all the screen is occupied by yours.
I don't know, just do escape and then you can make it smaller.
Okay, share screen, chat, record reactions, leave meeting.
No, not leave meeting, just make it smaller. Just press.
What, where?
You've got here. I mean, look, you've got here. This is out. This is.
But it's only you can steer. I can't click here. So you can make, if you can make it smaller.
You. But if you press escape on your thing goes.
Okay. Yeah. I see it. Now I can.
You can come back anytime you like.
Okay. I was very happy I opened yesterday Tastyworks platform. I have just downloaded but had not looked into it.
Fine. Do you have your training, simulating training open now?
No, it's installing updates.
Right. Next time, please have it ready, yeah? Because this is...
I try so much to make everything in time. But...
Right. Now, let that go. Go back to me for a moment, and then I can show you some things, please. Now, we've got a platform here from Ameritrade. Not everybody has this platform, but the people who do use it probably as a... dummy account, because it's very difficult to find dummy accounts in option trading, and you can get a simulating trading dummy trade at Ameritrade. That doesn't mean you can trade there, because they do not allow a lot of people in if you are not in the United States. The other platform you can use then, but then you've got to start trading totally and utterly with money, is the Tastyworks platform, who does take everybody. But you can download the thinkorswim simulating trading platform to start practicing. As you can see, it is here, it says so, simulated trading, and go to Ameritrade, phone them, ask them how to download it, and they will help you with that, and then you can go just in the simulated platform. What you see then, if you come here, is quite a few things. But I am now at the trade platform. And once you start trading options, this is where you go in first instance. But there is a lot for you to have a look at, and you get totally confused and utterly. So as you can see here, I'll make the annotations a bit easier to do. Annotate. As you see here, you've got the strikes. Now put that on. I'm still not totally used to it. Put that on 8 for the moment, which is much easier. Otherwise, you get incredibly confused. Now, we're going to first put things a little bit right. So we go up to setup. Can you see that at the top there is setup? I'll put a little thing around it, setup. Press that.
Yes, I can. Now I have my platform open.
Yeah, go to setup at the top.
Yes, and setup.
Then go to application settings.
Yes, application settings.
And you see all this. You've got account, notifications, order defaults, hotkeys, my profile at the top. And at the bottom, you've got account, orders, positions, active trader, system startup, look and feel, display, calculations, and language.
Yes.
Now, the account, don't do anything about that. Orders, single orders only is quite good for the moment. Positions, well, that is really important. So delta, gamma, theta, vega, which is good. Position laid out, open and day, that is all good. You leave that. Active trader, you leave this all as it is. System, you leave all that what it is. Startup. Last used. I do last used. You can, of course, do home screen, but what I would do is last used. Look and feel. What you have now on is dark, but you can have the light. You can have normal spacing. You can show for navigation. I would show. You can also have old school, which is this. You can have Chinese dark. I will do for the moment the dark, because I think that is the high contrast for the moment. So I apply settings. I go back up there, application, because I want to do something else. Display, well, 3 months is fine, that I leave all that. Calculation is standard, language is English. I go to notifications sent by email. Now, this is important. Order defaults. We do not do stocks, we do options. So go to the options trade. Default quantity of orders, put that on one.
Default
quantity of orders.
This is 10.
When you start on the platform, it says 10. Put that on one.
Default quantity of orders.
Yeah, and order quantity increment is also one. So put both of them on one.
Yeah, and then.
Have you done that?
Yes.
Right, settings, and then you are finished with that, which is good.
And what is the maximum quantity of orders? What would you suggest?
You start always with one for the moment. That is just.
But it stands maximum quantity of orders unlimited.
Yeah, but you can leave all that. Just do what I said. Put both on the one, and that's it.
Okay. Apply settings.
Apply settings. Now, what you have got open then now is what you see. I just opened I went to trade and I opened the 28th of February and I put Apple in. At the top, you can put your ticker in. That could be Apple, could be anything, Microsoft, Amazon. A ticker is the underlying stock. So there is where Apple goes. Then you press enter and then you get the option chain. That is important. Now, an option chain is all the dates. What we have got is all the option chain until June. We also have the weeklies in. We do trade weeklies. Some people do not trade weeklies and you can actually take them out, but I like to have them in. So I leave the weeklies in. So let's open a weekly, which is the 28th of February. What do we have then? Well, we've got the option chain. The filter is off, so we don't do anything. The spread is single. You can actually put a vertical in. A calendar spread, a diagonal spread, the straddle, the strangle. We do none of them at the moment. The only one we do is the vertical and the iron condor. So if you want to make sure that you don't quite know yet what the vertical in is, then put the vertical in. And then if you press something, you will get automatically a vertical. Then the layout could be anything, but we have put it on implied volatility, probability, out of the money, and delta. We've put that on. That's important. Then you've got at the left side, you have got the call, and at the right side, you've got the puts. And we have only got 8 strikes on, but I put 12 strikes on. Now you've got purple at the bottom, at the top, at the call side, and black at the bottom. At the put side, you've got black at the top and purple at the bottom. Now, what does that mean? Well, that is rather important. I will put a little bit more in because it's easy to sit. I put 20 here. Right. As you can see, which is interesting, is that when you are exactly, I just put this on a single in for the minute, because when you can see 310 and 312, at the moment, the stock Apple trades between the 310 and the 312. And exactly here, it is either at the money or in the money. Now at the puts, the purple side is always in the money. The black side is always out of the money. So at the put side, you are out of the money at the right side, and at the call side, you are at the bottom, at the black bit, you are out of the money. So there is a difference. It is totally opposite. Can you follow this thus far, everybody?
Yes, yes.
Good. Now, then at the top, we've got something else. We've got a strike, the bid and ask. Now, the bid is sell and the ask is buy. If you hover over it, you can actually see that. Very small sell, very small buy. Implied volatility is not there because it's in the weekend. Normally, you do see the implied volatility. The probability of being out of the money. When we sell, we are always out of the money. We are not in the money and we are not at the money. We are out of the money. And what we do want to know is the delta, which you can't see here either, but which I will explain. Now, how can you get these in? That went via that, which is absolutely great. Later you see more, but you can see something different here. If I close this, you can see implied volatility. They are different from the 21st of February to the 28th. You can see here it's 11%, there it's 32%, and then it goes down. And you see a number next to it. The number next to it is plus minus at the top. The implied volatility is 11.35%. And the number next to it is plus minus 0.541. Basically what it means is plus minus, it either goes down or up 55-45 cents, give or take. Now, the next one at the 28th of February, the implied volatility is 32%, give or take. And then suddenly you've got €11.45. It can either go up or down, depending if you're in or out of the money. So there you've got something very, very important. When we sell options, we want an implied volatility, an IV rank, as we call it, from over the 30, because the more implied volatility we have, the higher it is, the better it is for us. So when we sell, we want the implied volatility. We want to know that. And if you go to the screen, you can actually see that with the puts, probably out of the money and the delta. Now, what happens here with your delta and your probability out of the money? When you sell, you will see here the numbers of delta, which is important, by the way. When we sell, we want a delta around 30 to 35. If you've got 40, it's not a big deal, but I wouldn't really go over 40. I wouldn't go lower than 30 either. If I would have a delta of 20, I wouldn't sell an option, I would buy an option. Because what happens if your volatility goes down, your delta goes down, that means that your, so at the moment your delta goes down, your volatility has also gone up, gone down. If your volatility goes up, that means you've got a high volatility, which means that your delta is 30, 40, 50, 60, which is great, as long as you sell, because time doesn't, is not in of influence from with us when we sell an option. When we buy an option, we get really hammered with time decay. But when we sell an option, that is in our favor. So our delta does three things for us. It will tell us which direction it goes. It also will tell us how much we chances we have to be to stay out of the money. So if our delta is, for example, on the 305, I will put my annotation on there, you can actually see that. Say that we go, we do the 305, then our delta, say that that is 30, is great. So we are 70% chance then, if this is 30, we have got 70% chance that it is out of the money, and we've got a 30% chance that it will go in the money. Once it is in the money, we lose money because the buyer wants to have it. Because we bought it for 305, it's suddenly 315, which means, you know, the buyer thinks, oh, that's great, he's got to sell it for 315 to me, or he's got, I can buy it for 315. So we don't want that. So what we do want is we want to make sure that we stay at 305. When it goes down, then of course we are buggered, because we sold it at 305, the buyer can buy it at 219, we've got to sell it at 305 to him, but he only pays 290. So we are making a loss from 305 to 290. So we make a loss of 15 pence, which means times 100 is 15. Depending how many contracts we have, it can be, it's awkward. So it gives us, first of all, it gives us direction. Second of all, it tells us how much percentage does it have that we stay out of the money. But we also have something which is called touch. It can touch the 305. And when you have that, you actually double your delta. So in this case, it is 60% chance that it will touch my delta, the 305.
You mean 70% chances?
Yeah, you double your delta. So you've got 70% You double your delta. You've got 70% chance that you stay out of the money.
Okay. 70% chances that you stay out of the money.
Yeah, because you've got a delta of 30%. You've got a 60%, 2 times 30% delta, that it will touch your delta, your 305 position. And then you have got a 30% chance that you're going in the money. So that are the very basics of Delta, but Delta does more for you, but we'll go there in another time, otherwise it's far too much. We go more to that in a later date. What else does the Delta? Because the Delta is really, really, really important to you to look at things and to think of things and what it actually does to you and what can you read from it. Because if you understand Delta, then you also understand, well, most of the rest. Now, Delta measures how much an option moves given a $1 move in the stock price. So if the stock price goes up, say that Apple goes up $1, yeah? Then it tells you it measures the $1 move. So if you've got a 30 delta, well, it is 30 cents then. So your stock price moves up, or your option price goes up 30 cents. But if it goes down, so if the stock price goes down a dollar, you lose 30 cents. So the delta really measures your move of your stock price, which also then influences your option price. Now, sadly enough, the option price is always more influenced by the move of the stock price than the stock price itself, okay? If you know that you have got a 30 delta, it also provides you direction and exposure of that options. So if you've got a 30 delta, you know you are out of the money. If you have a 100 delta, you know that you are at the money or probably in the money. So the further you are in the black, the further you are out of money, the cheaper your options are. But if your volatility is high, the options are expensive, which means that you get more credit. Now, what do you want when you want to sell an option? You want as much credit as you can get. I mean, what do you want? Do you want a dollar or do you want 25 cents? Well, I want that dollar times 100. It's $100. If I only get 20 cents, then I only get 20 bucks. Now, if we really trade an option, we want as much credit as we can get because we do not wait until the end and the expiration of the options. At the moment, you have 50%. Say that you got your credit was a dollar, which is $100. At the moment, your credit, your option hits $50, you close that option. You always go for the profit. You do not start being greedy. So 50% is nice. Actually, when you trade an iron condor, you already do that with 30%. So at the moment that hits $30, you take it in. In that way, you will keep your profits. And the other side is if you are in the money and you've got some time left, then fine. You can make a choice. You can also, in that respect, you can also have a look what you're going to do. Now, the tasty trade way is simple. You leave your losers alone and you concentrate on your winners. That is a personal choice. I don't do that. I do that sometimes. If I've got plenty of times left, then I will do it. And sometimes I think I can close it now. I lose just a little bit of money. I don't see why this going. I don't see it going up or going down wherever I am. And I close it. But that is a personal thing. You have to try it out, which fits best with that. The Tasty Trade way is a simple way, and they've got good reasons to say so. So it's not a bad thing. But I have seen people, you know, leaving the trades alone and lost quite a few hundred dollars, which is not my way of doing things. You can roll, of course, an option, but then even then, you might lose money. So this is the setup when you start trading. Now say that we want to trade Apple and we are going to have a look at Apple to say, right, what is that going to do? You know, we don't know. We have got no idea. But we would like to know. But do we always know what an option is going to do or a stock? No, we don't. We can have a guess. But that doesn't mean that we do know. So let's take this one. And I hope everybody can see the next slide. Is that true?
Yes, I can see.
Right. This is a day chart of Apple. Clear. Undo. I'm not that good with this. Right. Let me make this bigger. This is a day chart, which I'm going to put in now. You've got the days here, the day, the week, the month. If you look at the chart, then always look at the day and the week and the month. So we first go and have a look at the day chart. Now, what is this day chart telling us? Well, since October, basically, August, Apple's gone up and 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 up. And if you were then in Apple, you would have made quite a bit of money. And as you can see, the coronavirus started around, you know, begin February. And you can see that when the news came, that Apple went down. Then it went up a little bit and we had earnings as well, therefore. Of course, when you can trade earnings, but I wouldn't recommend it when you start. But we've heard at earnings. And since the coronavirus, Apple is making all his, most of his telephones are made in China. So they already said that their profit would go down. Has it really been affecting Apple? Well, it depends how you look at it. It has gone sideways. It's gone up a little bit. It's gone down a little bit. It's perfect actually for a iron condor. So if you put an iron condor on 334 and you put the other side at 300, at the moment it is just bubbling along. We have a look at the week. Well, as far as you can see there, at earnings, isn't there anymore? You can see that it was a little bit like that, went up. Also, the week is having a sideways. Now, let's have a look at the month. Well, at the month, you can see that it has a huge candle. Now, I will change that to the bars here. Always more difficult to see. But what happened here? I'll take this one out. It opened here, the candle before that. It closed here. Now it opened here and it just closed above the other one, which means it has left a long wick. Now, what does that say? Well, if the wick is at the bottom, then the chances is that it will go up. Now the wick is really, it's a long wick here. The chances is that it will go down. Will it, is that a 100% certainty? No, there's nothing like 100% certainty, but there is a chance. It's a big week here. So I go back to the day, and then I say to myself, right, if I see this, do I have the feeling that this stock will really, really go up in the next 20 days? No, I don't know. I can't judge that. Can I judge the next week? I might. Will I say, is this a stock that I will now trade? No, it's not a stock when I trade. So let's have a look at another stock. Let's go to Boeing. Now, Boeing is a totally different matter if you look at this stock. First of all, it's going down. It's under the cloud. This is called the Ichimoku cloud. It's under the cloud. And the probability is that Boeing is going down a little bit more is quite likely, and certainly for the next week. So I would trade something as a weekly for Boeing to go down. I will do that. Amazon. Something is, why isn't he doing it? Oh, Amazon. Same here, it's a day candle. At the moment, Amazon is going down. Will he keep going down? He's got a long way to go, eh? He's really got a long way to go. So he's got room to go, and he's got room to go. This is his stop. So he can go up to 2185, which you can see here. And he can go all the way down. This is basically his support. It is an option to say to myself, I might trade that as a bearish trade. So if I say it's a bearish trade, then the question is going, am I then going to the puts, or am I then going to the calls? Well, and this is it. If you go bullish, you put a put on, you put a put call on, and a put vertical on. If you go bearish, you go short a call. Now, let me say that again. If you go bullish, you put a short vertical put on, you sell a put. If you go bearish like Amazon, you put a short call on. And then we have a look what we're going to do. Well, then we have a first look, made a decision to go bearish. Not an Apple, but let's put Amazon on. This is Amazon. This is an expensive stock, by the way. Huh. Probably, oh, this has got a delta, which is good. Now, you see that the puts have got deltas here, and you've got calls the deltas on. Oh, funny that it had this. Now, I want a delta of 32.30. So if I would sell a call here, a vertical call, I would go to this one. So what do I want to happen then? If I sell a call and I go bearish, which way do I want the market to go? Which way do I want that stock to go? Do I want that stock to go up, or do I want to go the stock down? I want the stock to go down. So at the moment it is trading for 2095. And I go for 30 delta, then I'm at 2130. So before that really bites me in the ass, it will take a while. So I sell. I left click, go all the way up, and I press the vertical. And automatically I have gone a sell, that's the minus. Minus one, because that's what we did. We buy a plus one. We sell the two. Let me get this. We sell the 2130 and we buy the 2135. The price, the credit we get is 130, which means 130. We have a limit order. If it is closed, we only want to get this option filled when the price is 130. If we leave it open, this little one, means that it will go with the market. We have a limit order. We don't want it for the day. We want it for the good till cancelled, the best one. And then confirm and send. What do we see? This is important. Huh? You bought a 2130 and you sold a 2130 and you bought a 2135. Your break-even stock is 213130. Now, let's write that down for a minute before I forget. Let me write that down. So my break-even, I would actually make a picture of that, but that's besides the point. So my break-even is 213130, okay? The maximum profit is 130 because your credit, what you got, was 130. Your maximum loss is 370. That is what it costs you. So if you lose, the maximum you can lose is $370 plus the 130 because you've got costs. Now, the 370 you also have to have in your account. That is your buying power. So if you don't have, say, 370 in your account, they will not fill it for you because they will say you have not enough in your account. So, okay, I sold it. So my break-even point was 213130. Okay, edit. If I go here, then I've got a little wheel. Go there, and then this is coming up. Now, why do I put this open? If I sell it, there we go again. So let me get this. I sell it at 2130, and my even is 2131. So it's just between the 2130 and 2135. I can actually say to myself that I put this on a buy. My limit price is, I can go back to 020, doesn't really matter. And I want to cancel this order. I want symbol, Amazon method, mark, trigger. If it is higher than, and now I put the 2131 in. Nope, what the heck? 2131 And then you see, submitted from buy the one vertical Amazon weekly at 20 cents or better. Note that after limit private. So what it says basically, that it will cancel it. So at the moment it hits your 2131, it will cancel it. And then you press this twice, and there you are. You only have to press it twice. is greater or equal to 2131. I must get rid of that one. So that's better. Always press twice. Otherwise, here, there it is. Cancel if the following condition satisfied: mark price of the security is greater or equal than 2131. So basically, then you don't lose anything. Say that you go on holiday and you have got no idea what when you're back. You have no idea if there is any internet. This is a way of making sure that you are not losing any money whatsoever. Do you always do that? No. Do I always do that? No. But sometimes I do. If I'm really unsure of something and I put that trade in and I think, well, I don't really want to lose any money, so I'll drill down my break-even point, then basically I end up zero. All I have then is the price of what I pay Ameritrade. Well, in this case, what I pay to Tastytrade. So I canceled it, but there you can see it. So confirm and send. You can do so. I won't, because it's not a trade I want to take at this very moment. Any questions up till now? Julia.
Thinking. It's a lot of information, and when the trade, when we're saying that we think that Amazon will go down, as I understand, it's bearish. So we have two possibilities: either to put to buy the put or sell the call. And how do we decide which one of them to take?
Because you do a vertical, you sell the call.
Okay, if it's the vertical, then you sell a call.
Yes.
You never buy a vertical.
Well, let's buy it. Let's have a look what happens. So let's say that we buy this. Wait a second. Delete.
We buy a put.
Yeah, we buy a put. So we say then.
And you have also, you can see delta, and delta, it's.
Well, this is it. You buy now a put, so it can't be 30.
No. Okay, when you buy a put.
You sell a put for 30, but you buy a put for much more. So your delta, you have to be in the money to buy a put. And then you get a debit spread. I'll show you. You buy, You buy a vertical. And then suddenly you've got a debit, which means you have paid. You have put up 300, your maximum profit is 305, but you have put $195 down instead of credit. So you've got suddenly a debit spread instead of a
instead of credit spread.
Yes. It's not what you want.
No. Okay. Some wheels start to.
So when you sell, you always get a credit. When you buy, you always have a debit spread.
Yeah.
You have a credit spread when the volatility is high. You want the option to be worth a lot, a huge lot, because the time decay makes sure that that option goes down in value, which is exactly what you want, because you don't want the buyer to say, well, I want that option. You don't want that. So you want the option go down. But if you have a debit spread, you want the volatility low. You want to buy it as cheap as possible, that you can sell it as high as possible.
Possible.
You get that?
Yeah.
So when you are selling a credit spread, you sell a short and you sell a put. You sell a call and you sell a put. The one means that you go bear bullish and the other one means that you go bearish. If you want a debit spread, you buy a call spread and you buy a put spread.
Okay. When we sell put or we sell a call, we get credit.
Yes. Always. When we sell, you get a credit.
When we buy a call or we buy a put, we have to be debited from our account.
Correct.
And of course, we want to have credit on our account. That's why we are the sellers.
Yeah, we are sellers. We have that credit. Now, I think this is enough for today. Thank you very much for participating. I hope this has been value to you and also to other people who look at this webinar. The next webinar is next week. We will continue this part. And Julia and I will continue a little bit private later on. So anybody else who listens to this webinar, thank you for listening to it. And I hope to see you with the next video.